November 1994, I'd seen a letter John had published in a UK newspaper, where he said he thought that there was a need in the UK for an organisation that helped men traumatised by circumcision. And I agreed with him. It's not really a major issue in the UK, in that not too many men are circumcised. So it's even more of an issue for those people who are, because they feel more out of it. And 19 of us met in a flat in London, and it was groundbreaking, really, because some of the men who'd been affected had never been able to express their feelings before, even to partners. It's something that they just kept to themselves. It was a filthy family secret. I suggested to John that he collected £5 from everybody who wanted to be involved, and we do a newspaper, a newsletter. And I ended up, I'd had experiences of editing newsletters. That's when our house magazine Norm UK was formed, and I've been the editor ever since. The breakthrough came when we were offered a 3-minute slot on a BBC Radio 4 programme called The Locker Room, and it dealt with men's issues. And we were allowed this 3-minute slot, but there was always somebody in those earlier interviews who had to counter what we said. And in this particular instance, it was a urologist from Stepping Hill Hospital in Stockport. And he said, "I'm afraid if this sort of thing catches on, it will be pandering to a lot of potentially inadequate people." However, it did pander to a lot of potentially inadequate people, and the movement has gained strength from that. The next stroke of luck was in 1996, when Victor Schoenfeld produced a groundbreaking documentary called It's a Boy. And he contacted some of the people at Norm UK. And I think I'm correct in saying it was the first programme on Channel 4 that went out without a commercial break. Several people tried to stop it being filmed. I mean, we were dealing with the medical aspect, but It's a Boy dealt with the religious side, with the Jewish issue, but it had medical aspects as well. What we didn't know at the time is how powerful that documentary was going to be. I was in the room when somebody said to Victor, Mrs. Hawksworth's had a boy, the filming's on. Victor saw my face and he said, "This is going to happen to this child anyway, and if what we're doing can save somebody else, then this is probably worth it." That was no consolation to me. What I didn't know, what was in store for the child. The bris actually started to go wrong, and one of the next sequences in the film was the father sitting outside in the accident and emergency.
"They've taken him off the monitors now. Before he was on oxygen, he was on he was on antibiotic drip, and actually when we brought him in, he needed oxygen so badly that they took him straight to the table in the receiving room and gave him oxygen immediately, and that brought back the colour in him. Once he'd been put in the ward, I took him up to the ward. He turned greyish again, a grey colour. You know, he looked like death warmed up, and I asked the nurse, you know, this can't be right, and consequently they put him in an intensive care unit where he is now. He's still there."
And the child, they didn't know at the time whether it was going to live. It had a very severe infection. And it was a very powerful documentary. And we were, I suggested to John Warren that now was the time to give Norm UK a bit of publicity, and perhaps we ought to ride on the back of this film. And Channel 4 agreed that they would put a recorded message at the end of the programme. So we had to have contact details. So I suggested we open a post office box. I got lumbered with answering the inquiries, and now I'm running the organisation as the general manager. So I really kept opening my mouth, and the more I opened my mouth, the more I got involved. It's something I haven't regretted. I feel that this is my legacy. This hopefully is something that I can pass on. The work I'm doing, if it helps anybody else, this is when I'm gone. That's my legacy.